that you'd help each one of us to hear from you, to grow in our faith, but mostly to grow closer to you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. I want to begin with an admonition. I came to church last Sunday and no one was here. Where were you? Oh yeah, someone sent out an email telling you to stay home. It's interesting when I think about not coming to church. It's like I'm missing something. It's that I'm missing that opportunity to worship God and to be with you. It's just not the same praying on my knees at home alone. Although that's important. But when we gather together and we worship God together, we are abiding in Christ in a unique way that is not possible on our own. And so today I'm departing from the lectionary and I'm using a passage from the Gospel of John for the sermon. So if you would, open your insert, your announcement sheet, and turn to the Gospel reading that I included. You can follow along. This is from the Gospel of John, chapter 15. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. As the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." I've been reading this gospel over and over again for days because it speaks to my heart. It speaks truth to my heart, to my mind, to my life. So the first thing I want to take away from this passage that we need to grasp a hold of is the simple truth that Jesus is the vine. Jesus is what it's all about. And if we don't abide in the vine, we're going to die. We saw that with the hurricane last week. All the leaves that got blown off of all the trees are now in a pile over there. And guess what? They're dying. Turning brown, and they'll wither away and break up into little tiny pieces and go into the dirt. And that's what happens to our life when we don't abide in Christ. We slowly die a spiritual death because we're not in Christ. He is the vine. The second thing is that he said that I want us to grasp a hold of, and there's so much here I could do a whole sermon series. He said, "You are already clean because of the word I spoke to you." We are clean because he's spoken a word to us that he has cleansed us. And he's cleansed us through the cross that he died on. Now, obviously, these words were spoken before he went to the cross. So what did he mean when he spoke these words to the disciples at that point? He was telling them that the words he was speaking to them, the truth that he was revealing to them, was the truth of God. And it's truth that sets us free. It's truth that cleanses us of unrighteousness, because it reveals that which is in us that is not of God, and that we can then be free of and be clean. So when we approach his word, when we abide in Christ, we're abiding in the word, and it cleanses us and keeps us clean. One of the things we were talking about over in Sunday school as we're looking at Screwtape Letters is how we are tempted by the world, the flesh, and the devil. And how easy it is to follow that temptation to its natural conclusion. Because at first it just seems rather innocent. God created pleasure. He created us to enjoy things. And they will tempt us. We'll be tempted by things that we enjoy. And what happens is we embrace them far too much, and they become our God. We indulge in them to excess. So by abiding in Christ, we are clean because we can see those temptations. We can see that what Satan is trying to do is lead us away from the truth, lead us away from what is good and clean pleasure to that which is overindulgent. So you see, when we abide in him, we can avoid all that. The third thing I wanted to mention is the overriding theme of this passage, abiding in Christ. He said, "He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit." To abide in Christ, or we will not bear fruit. We can strive and struggle and work hard, and yes, we'll see things happen and things will take place, but it's not the fruit that God's looking for. What is it that he's looking for? What kind of fruit is Jesus talking about here? Well, everywhere you look at fruit in the scriptures, it's talking about the fruit of our life. It's talking about our character. The fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace. That's what he's talking about. Because later on he said, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Not abide in him, but abide in his love. There's a critical difference there in those two things. On the one hand, we abide in him, then love, joy, peace, all those things are a part of our life. Then we can keep his commandments and love him and love others. And then we're abiding in his love that's ever present in any case. How do we do that? How do we abide in Christ? People often read this passage and they think, well, I'm going to church and I'm saying my prayers. I'm abiding in Christ. And yes, spiritual disciplines are a way, they are tools that we can use to bring us to a place where we are abiding in Christ. But they're not it in and of themselves. They lead us to a place where we can abide. Abiding in Christ, it's kind of like this. You remember when you were a child? And maybe you were frightened by something and you ran and jumped into your parents' arms or your grandparents' arms, somebody's arms, and they just held you close and tight and you just rested in their arms and you were calmed and at peace. Remember that? And if you don't, just imagine. Because it happened. At some point it had to happen. Well, that's kind of what it's like. It's resting in the arms of Christ. Abiding doesn't require any striving whatsoever. We rest in His arms. It's a natural just relaxing in His presence. The only activity required on our part is the desire to do that and to seek it out. And you seek it out in a number of different ways, through worship, prayer, other things, other spiritual disciplines. But you choose, it's a choice to abide in Him and rest in Him. And the more you do it, the easier it becomes. And of course, the world, the flesh, and the devil don't want you to do that. So they're going to do everything they can to distract you away from anything that looks like that. For instance, waking up on Sunday morning and not quite sure, I'm not going to church. I just don't have it this morning. I don't feel like it. You know, it's so easy to lose the battle of the sheets. Just roll over, go back to sleep. I mean, it's easy. It's such a subtle temptation. But we need to choose, we have to desire to abide in Christ. And then as we abide, as we do that, we'll bear much fruit. That's when fruit is evident in our lives, when we abide in Christ. And then you're filled with the Spirit. Jesus said in today's gospel reading from Matthew to love God and love your neighbor. But you can't do those things unless you're abiding in Christ. You can do it mechanically, you can do it by duty, you can make it happen by your own strength, but in some ways it'll be fruitless. It'll be dry. Because it's not in Christ. Let me just end with this little story. In his book, Deserted by God, author and pastor Sinclair Ferguson tells us this story. The first doctor to die of the AIDS virus in England was a young Christian. He contracted it while doing medical research in Zimbabwe. In the last days of his life, it became very difficult to communicate with his wife. And he struggled with increasing difficulty to express his thoughts to her. And on one occasion, she just couldn't understand what he was trying to say. And so he wrote on a notepad one letter, the letter J. And so she pulled out his medical dictionary and started throwing out these words, you know, started with the letter J and going into the medical stuff, and he was, no, shaking his head. And finally she stopped and couldn't think of any other J words, and then it hit her. Jesus. And he nodded his head. That was the right word. That was who was with them in that moment. And that word, His presence, is all we ever need. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we try to abide in You and in Your Son and in Your Spirit, we find it difficult. Want to understand it even more. So I pray, Father, that even if we don't have an understanding, You'd help us to do it anyway. That You would give us the grace and the mercy to do what we don't understand.